Hello and welcome back. Let's recap what we have seen so far in the previous videos. We have built a classification model in MATLAB and Simulink, and then we have tested the algorithm on our desktop computer to perform condition monitoring. After doing this, we have generated C code from it, and we have deployed it on a PLC. We have then tested the real-time behavior of the generated C code, and we have tested the PLC algorithm against a speed goat machine that represents the real-time behavior of the plant. So now let's make sure that we have performed a few tests in real-time and we are sure that the algorithm works well on the PLC. At this point, we are able to bring the PLC in the real field and use it with the real Flowpack machine. Thanks to the classification model that we built in MATLAB and Simulink, we can now detect whether there are any real physical issues on the electrical side or mechanical side on the real Flowpack machine. But this may not be enough for us. So maybe what we want to do now, we want to build another algorithm, and we want to build an algorithm that will be able to tell us how much time we have before any failure might occur. So we want to be able to not only spot and diagnose any abrupt fault, but we want to be a bit smarter about this. Let's take a step back now. Let's see how we can use the condition indicators or features to train a different kind of model. The model that we will build now is a prognostics model. That is a model that is able to perform remaining useful life estimation and can answer questions like, how much time do I have before the Flowpack machine fails? So let's jump into MATLAB again and let's see how this is done. So let's go here and let's open a different live script. So we're measuring data from the Flowpack machine and we have data measured every week. So we save this data in a CSV file, and we bring this all together in a folder. Let's take a look at this folder to see what data looks like. If we open here, we can see that we have a lot of CSV files, and the index of each of these files represents the week. So here we measure data once a week, and we just measure 20 seconds. So for example, here we have data from the first week, second week, third week, and so on. So let's see what it looks like. We just measure data every millisecond for 20 seconds. And we have data from different measurements. So speed of the motor, current of the motor, and position error. Okay, so let's go on and let's start to play with this data. So the first thing that we will do, we will build a file ensemble data store. So this data store is very useful to deal with a large amount of data. Okay, so let's go on and let's visualize the position error that we have measured over the different weeks. Essentially, we just want to take a quick look at the data to see if there is any issue. So here we have the plot. On the x-axis, we have the week number, and then on the y-axis, we have the value of the position error in degrees. So as you can see here, the first 90 weeks seem to be okay for our Flowpack machine, but then starting more or less from week 90, we can see that this error is starting to degrade. And this might be an indication. So this might be an indication that something is not working well with our machine, okay, maybe it's not filled yet, but there is something that we need to take a look at and monitor. So if we go on, we decide to discard the first 90 weeks because there is no degradation, and then we will use the rest for training. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the pre-processing of the data. We have seen this already in the previous videos, but essentially this is how we can perform a bit of pre-processing. So for example, we can smooth the data or cut the initial transient. Then we go on and we pre-process everything in parallel. So once the data is pre-processed, we can extract features. And then once again, we extract both time domain and frequency domain features. So we run the section and we extract the features in parallel. So once we're done, we create and save a table that will contain all the features that we have extracted. And in particular, we will discard the first 90 weeks because probably they're not going to contain any useful information for us. So this is what the table looks like. Again, we have around 28 columns, and that will be the number of features. Plus a column that we use to keep track of the week. And then we can reduce the number of features that we will work with. So as we did before in the condition monitoring case, we evaluate the correlation matrix of the features, and then we discard the features which are correlated to each other. So the features that we will work with for remaining useful life estimation need to have three important properties. Monotonicity, trendability, and prognosability. So you can have a look at our documentation to have further information on this, but let's focus now on the monotonicity. Essentially what that means, it means that our features need to be monotone as the health of the physical plant deteriorates. So for example, if we have a degradation in the physical plant, then the features need to increase or decrease. Otherwise, they're not good indicators. So for instance here, we see that from the remaining features that we have left, some of them have a good value for monotonicity and some others don't. So a way that we can further reduce the number of features is essentially choose the good features, which means features which have a high value for monotonicity. And we could have done the same also for trendability and prognosability. So in this case, what we'll do, we will discard all the features where the monotonicity is less than 0.95. Okay, and then as you can see, we now have only 6 features. And that means that we will be able to work with less amount of data. But we can take this a step further. We can perform principal component analysis. And this will help us to further reduce the features that we will use. So what we see here is the variance, which is explained by the new principal components. And as you can see, the first two principal components explain almost 100% of the variance of our data set. So that means that maybe the first two principal components are enough to explain the data set that we have. Then we go on and we decide to check whether the first two components are actually both monotone. And what we see here is that only the first principal component is monotone. So summarizing, that means that we will use the first principal component as health indicator of our machine. And then if we plot the trend of this first principal component, we can see that as the number of weeks increase, also the health indicator increase. So now the fundamental question is, what's the value of this health indicator, which means failure? So now, you know, we have different options here. So maybe we have a good knowledge of our system, and so we know what value indicates failure. Or maybe we have experienced failures in the past with similar machines. But if none of them is possible, what we can do, we can reuse our Simulink model as a digital twin to actually get the value that represents failure for us. And so what we do here, we just inject faults in our system. We simulate the model. And then at the end of the simulation, we get the value of the threshold that for us means failure. Okay, so once this is done, we can start to build our exponential degradation model. And this is a model that will be able to tell us how much time we have before our flowback machine fails. So to do this, we just need to use the exponential degradation model from the predictive maintenance toolbox. And then we need to set some parameters. So we run the section, and then we take a look at the model that we have just built. Okay, so how can we use this model for remaining useful life estimation? Well, the way this works is in a couple of steps. So the first one is updating the model with the new data that we measure over time, so as the number of weeks goes by. And then after updating the model, we just need to call the predict RUL function. So this brings us to the end of this video. If you want to have further details on how this model performs, and if you want to have more details on how we can deploy it, stay tuned and I'll see you in the next video.